Students often underestimate the amount of skill and effort required to design a good questionnaire. They often think that it's going to be quick and easy, they'll just write a few questions and it's done. Actually, designing a good questionnaire is hard work. But there are a few easy ways of improving the quality of the questions in your questionnaire. In this video, I'm going to explain four questionnaire design tricks that could help you to improve your questionnaire in two ways. First, they will help you to improve the clarity of the questions in your questionnaire. And second, they will help you to collect more data in a single question. I'm Miguel Moital. I am the founder and chief content developer of the Dissertation Academy. So let's start with the four tricks. What is the first trick? The first trick is to avoid yes-no questions. Let's look at an example. This question is asking participants at an event if they have attended the event before, and the answers are yes or no. We can actually ask the same question, but we can withdraw more information out of it. The question would be reformulated to what years have you attended the event? And there are five options from 2017 to 2021. This was an event that had started in 2017, and therefore we only needed to include the five years. And there's also an option at the end to say none of the above for those who had not attended the event. And from here, we can identify the yes if they tick at least one box from 2017 to 2021. It means they attended before. And if they tick the last box, it means it's a no. So we still get the same yes-no that we had in the first question. But we can obtain two additional bits of information. The first bit of information refers to when they first attended and last attended. So let's say someone ticked 2017, 2019, and 2021. We have the information that they attended 2017 as the first time they attended, and 2021 as the last time they attended. We can also find out how many events they attended in the past. So going back to the previous example, it means that we could record on SPSS, assuming that's the software you are using, we could record that they had attended three events before. So as you can see, by doing a little tweak in the question and then in the options that participants can choose from, we obtain not only the yes-no that we would get if we were using the first style, but we can get more information. The second trick is to make changes to the questions so that you can expand the pool of knowledge. The second one actually allows you to collect different data about your participant. We can change the question actually to try to understand how they engaged with each of the past marathons during the event, so as the event was happening. And here, there are basically three ways of engaging with the event. You can either run at the event, you can be a spectator watching it live, or you can be a spectator but through media, because the event is covered in media. And obviously, there must be also an option that says none. Let's see what information we get by changing both the question and the possible answers to the question. To start with, we can continue to get our yes and no. So if students tick any box in terms of running, live street spectator, or live media spectator, it means they have attended the event. And if they say none, it means for that year they didn't attend the event. But we can get more information than that. The next thing we can get is the type of participation. We got the yes, no, did they attend or not? But we also have in what capacity did they attend? And that can be useful information to understand how they got involved with the event. The second element is about when they first and last time have done it. They attended the event, but unlike the previous format, we can answer that question based on the modes of participation. So when they first and last ran, when they first and last were a street spectator, and when they were first or last media spectator. The next bit of information that we can also extract from asking the question this way is about the number of events attended. But unlike the previous format, which was just how many events they attended, we can answer that question here by mode of participation, by mode of engagement. So how many times they attended the event as runners, as street spectators, and as media spectators. By asking the question in a slightly different way and offering more detail in the options, we can obtain not only the information that we were getting before, but more information that allows us to obtain more detail about our participants' participation in the event. The first two tricks are about expanding the pool of knowledge. In other words, asking the question in a slightly different way so that you can obtain more and better information, while the other two tricks are about improving the way you are asking the question. It really doesn't change the answer that you're going to get, but you will get a more valid answer. The first trick is about adding context to the question. So you always have a dilemma about whether you add the context to the question itself or to the statements, to the items in the measurement scale. Let's look at an example to see how it works in practice. The example here is from a study on sponsorship outcomes, and in this instance, purchase intentions. The question is, to what extent do you agree with the following statements? And as you can see, the context is in the statement. As a result of the sponsorship, after I know the sponsorship, as I know the sponsorship. There are two issues here. The first is that the context is slightly different as a result of the sponsorship, after I know the sponsorship, which sometimes is not beneficial as you're asking questions about slightly different things. But the other one is that you are using a lot of words in the statement and making them perhaps overly long or longer than they could be. What happens if we remove the context from the question? It vanished, yeah? You get the actual statement, the purchase intention bit. I would consider using the sponsor's products, makes me more likely to buy from the sponsor the next time I buy water. I will frequently buy from the sponsor, and I intend to buy the sponsor's products within 6 months. And the scale, for your knowledge, the scale was a 5-point Likert scale from a strongly disagree to a strongly agree answer. Obviously, now the statements are out of context because neither the question nor the statements provide the context that the respondent, the participant, should be thinking about when providing an answer. So the solution here is to actually move the context to the question. So the question now reads as thinking about the sponsorship of the event by the sponsor. Obviously, in practice, there was an event and a sponsor, a specific event and a sponsor, but for the sake of the exercise, I removed them. Please continue the sentence. As a result of the sponsorship, and then the four options. And in this instance, the options themselves are very straight to the point. There's no confusion. It's much less prone to misinterpretation or information overload because they are shorter and simpler to understand. But at the same time, the context is at the beginning. So they know that they need to answer each of those statements in relation to the context, or more specifically, as a result of the sponsorship of the event by the brand, by the sponsor. If you are enjoying the video, please press the like button. And if you are not subscribed, consider subscribing to the channel and hitting that bell button so that you are notified every time we release a new video. Talking about subscriptions, there's a Virtual Tutor online resource available for subscription. And the resource is a video book-based resource which contains a lot more tips and tools to help you write a better dissertation. I'll add the link in the description below. The next trick is about being as specific as possible. And when you're writing your questions and your statements, the more specific you are, the more clear the question is going to be. And at the same time, the cognitive load that is required to answer the questions will be reduced. And that's a good thing. When you're asking lots of questions, you want to keep them as simple as possible so that your participants don't get tired. If they have to think more than they need about the question and what it means, it means that they're going to get tired earlier, and therefore they may quit or they may give you, you know, easy answers just to get through it. Let's go back to the example that we've looked at in order to see how this works in practice. The measurement scale at this stage includes the sponsor's products in the statement or the sponsor. And that's a bit vague because in this instance, the sponsor was a water brand. What about if we change sponsor's products and the sponsor by the water brand? Let's see what happens. So the first one would be something like, I would consider buying the water brand. The second one is, I'm more likely to buy the water brand next time I buy water. I will buy the water brand more frequently, and I intend to buy the water brand within 6 months. It may sound just a little change, but actually it's better in terms of the focus, and therefore it reduces the cognitive load of the participant when answering, i.e. the mental effort that they need to do, but also it makes the statement even sharper. And that's always a good thing. The simpler, the more direct to the point the statement is, the better, not only in terms of the fatigue of the participant, effort that is required, but also in terms of the validity, because you leave no scope for ambiguity. Once you implement your questionnaire and collect your data, it's time to analyze it. And if you want to know more about how to go about analyzing your data, I recommend that you watch this video, which offers the two-step data analysis strategy to help you master your data analysis.